Good morning.
Thanks for being here. I am an energy practitioner and Reiki teacher here in Virginia Beach. I'm also a highly sensitive person, so I have a special interest in this topic. And the more I learned about it, the more comforting and validating and helpful I found the information. So it's one of the reasons why I decided to do a talk on this. I started my professional life as a speech therapist and then did adult education for many years and then segued into the energy work that I do now. So just to be clear, next month's talk is on Are You Psychic? So the kind of sensitivity that I'm going to be talking about today is really a physical, neurological kind of sensitivity. It's not so much a psychic sensitivity. But you'll understand more as we get into the topic. And before we get started, I just want to let you know that there will be a Q&A section at the end, but if you have questions as I'm speaking, feel free to ask them. I have no problems at all with interaction and with answering questions as they arise. So we're going to start out, it said in the description of the talk that you will find out, if you don't already know, if you have any doubts, you will find out, relatively for sure, whether you are a highly sensitive person. So I do have these. Rosie, can you help me give these out? I'm going to hand out this self-test. And it's just a little check mark. You check the statements that apply to you. I'm just going to give you them all because I don't really need them. Check the ones that apply to you. And this self-test comes from hsperson.com, Elaine Aaron's website, and she is the pioneer. She's a psychologist and a pioneer in this area. So she was gracious enough to give me permission to reprint her self-test, and so you have it in front of you. So I'll give you just a couple minutes to go through and check the statements that are true or mostly true for you. If for some reason you don't get a handout, that often happens. Well, we will talk about, yeah. So I would say go with what you know is your innate, natural self at your core. So I would say without the strategies, what are you at your most essential self? Rosie, folks that are coming in, can you make sure that they get the self-test, please? The checklist. There should be a front and a back. It's the two-sided checklist. Do you enjoy meditating, prayer, reflecting on your experiences, journaling?
Mm-hmm. What do you mean by sensitive to caffeine? I love it.
You know, I do too, and I can't drink it.
It really helps.
So if you're sensitive to caffeine, I love caffeine too, but unfortunately I've gotten to the point where I can't have any at all. So tea is my favorite drink, and all I can have are herbal teas that are caffeine free. So most people know, can you handle a cup of coffee? If I can't handle a cup of coffee, I would be swinging from fans with even one cup of coffee. So just based on the average. And again, this checklist is on Elaine Aaron's website, which is www.hsperson.com. So you can always go back and refer to it, or if you know someone, if you have a loved one who you think might like to take this self-test, it's the exact same one that I have up here. So is anybody surprised? So the instructions say if you checked 14 or more, that you are probably a highly sensitive person. So did you tally? Did you tally your check marks? So is anyone surprised by the results they got? A couple of people are surprised. And if you choose, a show of hands for people that are highly sensitive, or when they read this, maybe it didn't apply to them, but it applies to a loved one or someone close to them. How many of you was that the case, where it's you or a loved one? Okay. So what is high sensitivity? Basically, it is a finely tuned nervous system. So whereas all people perform best at a certain level of stimulation, all people, highly sensitive and non-highly sensitive, have a window of stimulation where they're not bored by being understimulated, and they're not so overstimulated that they're stressed. So about 80% of the population, that window of optimal stimulation is about here. For highly sensitive folks, that window is about here. And what that means is highly sensitive people reach that threshold of overwhelm and overstimulation faster than 80% of the population. So if you've ever wondered what's wrong with you, if you are indeed a highly sensitive person, and you've ever wondered what's wrong with you, the answer is nothing. There's nothing wrong with you. You just have a sensitive nervous system. The way you process information is different and more finely tuned than the majority. But anytime we're different, it can make us question ourselves and make us feel odd or make us feel inferior. 15 to 20% of the population falls, so high sensitivity, if we look at it as a spectrum, 15 to 20% are gonna fall at one end of the spectrum. Now, there are other gradations of sensitivity. So maybe you're not highly sensitive. Maybe you're more here, you are sensitive, but you're not highly sensitive. There's a good part of the population that falls in that area. But about 40% of people say they're not sensitive at all. So most highly sensitive people are surrounded by folks that are somewhere at the other end of that spectrum. In fact, obviously the majority of the population is. So that's why it's really important to know that This trait is basically a neutral trait. It's a physical, neurological trait. And what it means is loud noises. It can be bright lights. It can be crowds, strong smells, coarse fabrics. Any of those things can bother you and send you into a state of overstimulation, which often results in feeling overwhelmed. Again, any questions, comments, concerns, please feel free. Sure.
I'm curious, if this is a trait that's like plastic throughout the lifetime, if it can change.
It does change. It is very dynamic. So everybody gets more sensitive as they get older. Children and older folks tend to be the most sensitive. Adolescents and young adults tend to handle their sensitivity a little bit easier than children and older folks. But not only is it found in people, but it's also found in animals. So, and it seems to be inherited. It appears as frequently in men as it does women, or as many baby boys are born highly sensitive as baby girls. And within the animal kingdom, they also exhibit high sensitivity at a rate of about 15 to 20%. So there are highly sensitive dogs and cats and horses and monkeys and even rats. So this truly is a neurological, physiological, I don't even want to say a state, trait. It's a trait. Sure. I'm not aware that there are particular breeds within species, but over 100 higher functioning mammals, and my research says over 100 species exhibit, 15 to 20% of them exhibit high sensitivity. So you may have a sensitive cat or a sensitive dog or a sensitive hamster. So 15 to 20% of the population, as many males as females, it appears to be hereditary, and it does not apply only to people. It applies to mammals across the spectrum. And you asked if it's plastic. The other thing that we'll talk about a little bit later is a question that this woman brought up is high sensitivity, as with a lot of other traits we have, we do learn coping mechanisms and we do learn to adapt. Because we are highly sensitive, in order to protect ourselves, we normally learn a few different ways of managing our life so that we do not stay in a state of overwhelm or a state of stress. So there is this distinction between what we are at our core and our natural selves and how we present to the world. I'm highly sensitive and I taught in prisons for 8 years. I'm doing a public talk, a public speech. So we will talk a little bit later about personas. We do learn to put on different hats, right? To function socially as we need to function. So do be aware that there is a difference between how we feel, how we are, and how we have to be in the world sometimes. So what exactly is high sensitivity? It means you're more aware of subtleties in the environment. Your brain and nervous system are designed to process information and reflect on it more deeply. And it can appear sometimes that you process information more slowly. And it's just because the information is going at a deeper level, and we tend to like to reflect on it. So it may look like a slower processing, when in fact, it's really a deeper processing. But we are a package deal. So while we are more aware of subtleties in the environment, for instance, you might walk into a gathering, a party, a social gathering, and a highly sensitive person might be aware of some tension in the room, or maybe the lights are a little bright, or maybe the air is kind of stale, or maybe they're aware of the mood, the overall mood in the room. Whereas a non-highly sensitive person walks in and they notice the people and the furniture and where's the food. So there are really, really unique and wonderful things about being highly sensitive. We tend to be more intuitive because we pick up on information not just consciously but also at a subconscious level. We tend to be very conscientious. We tend to be very well prepared for things that we do. Actually, I'm kind of skipping ahead to the next slide. So I'll talk about the good things. I'll go back to that in a minute. So the challenges are we get overwhelmed more easily than our non-HSP friends and family members. So sights and sounds that are ordinary to others, such as large crowds or loud music, are overstimulating and stressful, and they can be very uncomfortable. Going to a mall at Christmas time is generally not a favorite HSP activity. No. Barking dogs, sirens, large crowds in general, even barking concerts, dogs. Barking dogs, yeah. I have found that even noise from my neighbors, even when it's noise they have a right to make, like mowing their, I don't, power tools, blowers, you know, leaf blowers, oh my, I do not love a leaf blower. They bother me. Now I've learned to deal with it. I don't live in isolation, I live in the suburbs. But things that other people easily tune out, HSPs generally have a harder time doing that. I know a lot of folks like to study and read with background noise, TVs or music, and a lot of HSPs really require quiet and solitude in order to concentrate and to process. So there's a lot of misinformation about highly sensitive person. This was not even identified as a trait until the 90s. So a lot of people in here were probably brought up by folks who were not, maybe still are not, aware of high sensitivity. And highly sensitive children do need special treatment. They do need special handling in order for them to grow up feeling confident and feeling like they can function in the world. So high sensitivity may be characterized as timid, shy, introverted, weak, or unsocial. Shyness, while a lot of highly sensitive folks are these things, they are not the same thing. About 70% of HSPs are introverts, which means they enjoy being around fewer people and quality interactions versus large crowds and strangers and quantity of interactions. But about 30% of HSPs are extroverts. So it is possible to be an HSP and be an extrovert. And that just means that person would enjoy parties, lots of friends, meeting strangers, but other things might overwhelm them, like a long day at work, or a day in the city, and being bombarded by all that stimulation. Shyness is generally a learned activity. Shyness is not inherited. So if you have been called shy, you may indeed be shy, or you may just be highly sensitive. But we tend to have a bit of a negative connotation associated with shyness in this culture. In Asian cultures, shyness is highly regarded. And in fact, studies have been done with Canadian children and Asian children. And when asked, when children, school children were asked which characteristics they preferred in their friends in Asia, shyness was at the top of the list. In North America, it was at the bottom of the list. So shyness is usually a result of, we go into a social situation, we're nervous, it doesn't work out so well, and so we have a negative experience. The next time we're in that situation, we arrive in a heightened state of stress and over-arousal and nervousness. It may not go so well, and this pattern results in us being shy and feeling like it's not so easy for us to meet new people or make new friends. But just be clear that it is a different, it's really, shyness is a state, it's not really a trait, whereas high sensitivity is a trait. Again, most highly sensitive people are introverted. They do want and need time alone. They do need silence. They do need more rest. They tend to need more rest than other folks. In order to soothe those nerves that tend to get jangled a little bit easier than other folks. Most people, HSPs and non, tend to become more sensitive as they get older. And as I mentioned before, as many men as women. But of course, it's even more challenging for men because of social and cultural expectations. Men have, there is this pressure to be outgoing, to be driven, to be aggressive. So highly sensitive boys can have some real challenges. What they often do is they learn to compensate, and they learn to do what they have to do in order to function in the world. And it usually works out well for them, and that they can function fine. But inside, they're still that highly sensitive person. Being highly sensitive can actually be, it has lots and lots of wonderful qualities that are needed in the world. So compared to non-HSPs, most HSPs are better able to spot errors and avoid making them. So they tend to be really good at detail-oriented work because they will discriminate things into finer categories than most folks will. They tend to be very conscientious. They want to do a good job. They want their work to be right. They want it to be well done. They feel it. If they feel that they have put out a product or service that is not meeting their high standards, they're able to concentrate deeply when without distractions. So they are also very good at learning, even when they don't mean to, at taking in information, processing it, retaining it and truly learning it without effort. If you're not an HSP, you're wonderful too. I don't want you to think that that you're not, but you probably already know it, right? If you're not, then you probably already know it. HSPs often grow up and come along wondering, why am I different? What's wrong with me? So these are all the things that are not wrong with you. They tend to be highly empathetic and can read others' moods and often know what to do to make another person feel more comfortable or more at ease. So one of the ironies of being highly sensitive is you may not be very comfortable at large parties or large gatherings, but HSPs are often actually socially gifted because they can read between the lines, because they can pick up on the subtleties in people's body language, in their expressions, in their communication, that other folks would simply not pick up on. Yes?
What do you do if it becomes overwhelming? Like, if you pick up on the moods and it feels like it's coming down on you?
Well, we always have options. It, of course, depends on what kind of gathering you're in. If you're in a social gathering, you always have the option to leave. hopefully. I have learned when I go to parties or social gatherings, it's fun to go with a friend so we can chat, but I go by myself most of the time so that I can leave when I'm ready to. And I don't have to drag somebody who's having a good time because I've reached my saturation point. You can look for another HSP. So kind of scan a room, see if you catch someone's eye, and if you can connect with another HSP, then that's going to reduce your stress level. You may just, depending on the situation, have to put on your persona. You know, there are times when we have to put on our, whatever it is you do for a living, or the different roles that you fulfill, put on that hat, know that it's temporary, parties don't last forever, and get through. So there are a few different little strategies that you may just need a break. Like, separate yourself to give yourself a little bit of time to settle down, go to the restroom. Sometimes I'll just go outside. Most people won't miss you if you just dip out for 5 or 10 minutes, right? Especially the non-HSPs. They're engrossed. They're having a good time. They're feeding off this energy. I've left reunions and people didn't know for days that I was gone. So you can just kind of dip out a little bit or set yourself aside, maybe move along to the perimeter. Sometimes it's helpful to just be able to step back and kind of observe and realize that what you're feeling is not fear. It's just over arousal, and you just need to step back, observe, say, okay, this is not a threat, it's not unsafe. Acknowledging that you're over aroused, that you're overstimulated, can be very powerful. So just saying, you know what, this is a little bit much, that's why I'm feeling like I am, I just need to remember that there's a lot going on, I'm feeling it, and really go get a drink or something to eat, or just a lot of times movement can help you. You had a question.
Well, I was just saying, I use a mantra techniques. You know, I think of light, you know, I think of light a lot.
Uh-huh.
I may need to think about peace. I may mm-hmm. need to think about harmony, but it's a mental diet.
Right.
Like pills into your mind, right?
Right. Right, so you have developed some strategies that work for you, right? And most of us will, to a degree, whether we realize it or not, there will just be things that we kind of instinctively do when we feel uncomfortable or we feel overstimulated. And that's perfectly okay. You have a right to be you, and you have a right to feel comfortable. So do what you need to do to feel comfortable. Yes?
I'm introverted, and going to parties, usually introverts like one-on-one.
Yes.
And if they go to a party, they got to sleep the next day because their energy is like zapped.
Exactly.
So I became an event planner.
Yeah. It provides you a container. So boundaries and containers can really help us when interacting with others. So you were very clear that you were at work. You adopted your work persona. You were a professional. You were a professional party planner. You're at work. And these are the things you do. So that was one strategy that you may not have even been aware of, that you adopted your work persona. And again, because it was, in general, a familiar environment, and it was contained in a way because it was work. So that helped you manage all the stimulation that goes with being a party planner. Now, did you find after a day of attending event, planning event, then attending it, did you find that afterwards you needed to compensate with, like, go home and rest, or?
Yeah, I had Velcro breath on the sofa for the next day. In other words, it was, you think you're energized and you think you, it just drained your energy, but you're happy.
Right. Right. Absolutely. I taught in prisons for 8 years, maximum security prisons. Now, when I went home, I was done. I was done. There wasn't a whole, even my social life was very thoughtful and deliberate, because after working in that environment and with such needy folks, all day, every day, I had to compensate by going to the other end of the extreme with rest, solitude, silence, as much as possible to replenish my well, or I wouldn't have had anything to give to my students. And it's not, I knew early on that it's not something I would be able to do till retirement. I would not have been able to stay at the top of my game and do a good job and give those folks what they needed if I had done it for a long time, because I'm just not designed. Extroverts tend to feed off and become energized by the energy of other people. Introverts are often drained by other people and actually recharge with, again, solitude and silence. And there's two questions. I'll get you and
well,
then.
I wanted to add on to what you were saying about, you know, working events as opposed to attending events. Like for me, because I've, you know, I've done a little bit like working for caterers, and I don't feel nervous about attending a you know, or to a party, like I feel so much pressure to act like or feel like everybody else feels that I just get nervous and I don't want to be there and I hate it.
Right.
I can't behave like that. I can't just dance and have fun and it's just not, you know, who I am.
Right.
I get overwhelmed, so.
You know, the amount of control we have over a situation has a lot to do with how stressful or overwhelming it is. A lot of times, like music, loud music can be really uncomfortable or bothersome to you, unless it's music you're playing, right? I have been known to crank up some music and really enjoy it. But if it's somebody else's music, it's noise, what are they thinking, turn that off. So a lot of what affects us has to do with the amount of control. Our own dog barking, because we can usually get it to be quiet, doesn't bother us as much as the neighbor's dog barking, because we don't have the control over that. When we are at work, not only is there a different set of expectations, we're at work. It's not fun time. Even when it's party time, it's not really party time if you're the event planner, right? You're at work and you've got to make sure that things run smoothly. Whereas in social situations, you know, it's more casual. There's the light chit chat that a lot of HSPs don't enjoy, kind of the light superficial chit chat. HSPs tend to prefer deeper, more meaningful, more qualitative interaction. And if you're in a typical social situation, a wedding, a party, it's mostly that lighter stuff that's taking place. So that might have something to do with while it's more comfortable for you when you are working and interacting in that role, versus that much looser and much more casual role of being attendee. And there are expectations. There are social expectations that if you're at a party, that you're going to engage and interact to a certain degree. And then, yes. Yeah, absolutely. And that's pretty typical for HSPs. Yeah. There's also a type of stress called eustress. E-U-S-T-R-E-S-S. Eustress. Eustress is good stress. Eustress is what I felt all morning, knowing I was going to come here, even though I didn't sleep well last night. It is what has me up here and able to do this without yawning and rubbing my eyes and, you know, wanting to take a nap. So eustress can be a good thing. As highly sensitive people, it can be our friend. When we have just that right amount of stress that we need to help us perform and function, almost like caffeine, right? Just like caffeine can help you sharpen your mind, sharpen your senses. Eustress literally means good stress. So eustress can be an HSP's friend because it'll help get you to that zone where you're functional, you're comfortable without being overwhelmed, overstimulated, overly stressed. All right, what else do we have up here? So those are some of the wonderful things about being an HSP. Like I said before, we are a package deal. And so there are some challenges. So compared to non-HSPs, most HSPs are a little bit more cautious. We tend to be more inward focused. We usually need extra time alone. Solitude is usually a good friend of HSPs. And the big one is we reach a state of overwhelm much faster and much easier. Hopefully, as we go through life, we have more people in our life through our discernment in choosing who we have in our life, of having people, even if they're not HSP, that they at least understand that we are. So I had a really good friend who is at the other end of the spectrum. She's a sales manager, she's loud, she's outgoing, she never met a stranger. If she's in a room, you know she's in a room. And yet, she understood that I'm not like that, and I'm probably gonna be the first person to leave a party if I go. The nice thing is she was always really happy if I went. If I go, she knew that I may very well be one of the first ones to leave. And she knew not to push me beyond my comfort level. So it's good to have those people in your life. The nice thing, HSPs are necessary. This world, this country needs HSPs to balance the warriors at the other end of the spectrum. We are outnumbered. So Elaine Aaron says that HSPs belong to the advisor class, the priestly advisor role. We are the Merlin to King Arthur. And we are absolutely necessary to this country and to the world. Because we tend to be introverted and we don't rush out and we don't make a lot of noise, we're not the ones that are generally running the show. But we need to be a part. We have to find this balance between being out in the world and sharing our gifts with the world and being in enough to take care of ourselves. And it can be a lifelong process of finding that balance between two out and two in. And just know that there may be a lot of trial and error. And that's okay. The problem with being too in is the more you stay in, the more sensitive you become, and the harder it becomes to go out and to function. So we do want to be mindful, even when we would really like to stay in with our books and our music and our journals and kind of hide away. The world needs HSPs. And you don't want to get to a point where you can't function in the world. So you do, as an HSP, need to push a bit to get out there so that you don't get so sensitive that you don't want to be out there at all. So I love this quote. This is from Elaine Aaron's book, The Highly Sensitive Person. This is the seminal book on high sensitivity. It is the, if you only read one book or go to one source of information, this is the one I recommend. When I read this for the first time, it was so validating and it was so helpful. And it shines a light on all the positive, wonderful contributions HSPs have to make versus the negatives that we we are often brought up to feel. So she says, every social group, family, organization, town, or nation, needs its sensitive people to balance those equally wonderful folks at the other end of the spectrum who make the great test pilots, ambulance drivers, soldiers, and sales managers. But these not-so-sensitive types process things less deeply and behave with a decisive boldness that can later turn out to be an impulsive lack of thought about consequences. So we need people who are going to think about the consequences of actions to other people, to children, to the environment, to animals. So while there are those bold people who are saying, let's do this, let's do that, let's go, let's get it done, it has to be balanced by the more sensitive people who are saying, hold up, let's think about this for a minute and think about the consequences and who may be affected and how they may be affected. I think one of the reasons why the planet is in such bad shape today is because HSPs aren't running the world. If HSPs were in more powerful positions and were making more decisions, I really truly do believe that. I won't even talk about bigger issues because this isn't the place, but well, I'll stick to the environment. But I certainly think the planet and the environment would be in much better shape than it is now. Yes?
There's a new book out. It's a brand new book. It's called The Nature Fix by Florence Williams. And it studies around the world about what different governments and all are doing who have realized that nature helps us heal.
Exactly. Right.
It will put the fear of whatever into you. Anyhow, it's a great book. And in Japan and in Korea, they are having forest healers as a part of the official, they're finally realizing this is absolutely needed.
And HSPs tend to benefit from being in nature. They generally have an affinity and an appreciation for being in nature, animals, nature.
According to the book, 80% really benefit by being in nature, but there are some 15 to 20% on the other extreme who do not. They just don't benefit.
I agree. I think most people benefit from it, but HSPs,
really?
I think, will have a deeper appreciation. While everybody, I think most people would benefit to some degree, HSPs tend to have a deeper appreciation for nature, as they have a deeper appreciation for many of the subtler things in life. Subtle taste, subtle smells, fine things, the subtle, tend to be overlooked by the majority, are deeply appreciated by most HSPs. So I like this quote, and I think that there's a lot of truth to this in the necessity of HSPs being out in the world and lending our calm, thoughtful voice to decision making. If you are an HSP, you need to be particularly mindful about taking care of your sensitive body and your sensitive nervous system. Self-care is important for everybody. It's critical if you're an HSP. Yes?
I think it runs in my family. And also autoimmune.
Disorders
are in my family too, and I wonder if there's a connection.
There may be. A lot of people think that autoimmune disorders are directly or indirectly related to stress. Stress wreaks havoc with our bodies and our systems. So it makes sense that if you are basically more prone to, if you want to call it stress, overstimulation, overwhelm is a state of stress. So they're absolutely, if HSPs, when they take good care of themselves, they are healthier than the majority. When they do not take good care of themselves, they're not as healthy as average. HSP children, if they are in a nurturing environment that allows them to be themselves, they are healthier than most children. If they have caretakers who don't understand their trait, they tend to be less healthy. So yes, I think there absolutely could be a correlation between that. One of the most critical needs for HSPs is rest. You may need more sleep and downtime than your non-HSP family and friends, and that's okay. Yes.
Are the HSPs born that way?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Now, it can change, you know, and because, again, of conditioning and shaping and strategies, our sensitivity can change. But it is an innate trait that we are born with and can be observed in babies. So a lot of times fussy babies or colicky babies are really just HSP babies who are overstimulated. And they can't tell you why they're overstimulated. They can't ask to be removed. So they communicate in the ways that babies communicate. They cry, they fuss.
Child, as opposed to how I was born, the youngest of 10 children, the sensitivity with me was buried as I grew up.
As it often is.
And I developed it later on as I got older.
Right.
As opposed to an only child where their needs were supposedly met. So I know there's a question in, there's a correlation between the
Well, as a child, as a highly sensitive child, in a,
chaotic.
I was thinking that, but I, yeah, in a noisy, chaotic environment, you had to survive, right?
Right.
You, as a child, could not say, you know, this is not a good fit for me, and I'm going to go have to live someplace else, right? You had to deal with the situation that you were born into, and you did. So you probably developed strategies, as you think back, you probably developed strategies to help you survive and to help you cope. The problem is that sometimes your strategies and your way of coping can be labeled negatively. My parents thought I was unsociable. Because I didn't enjoy sitting out and watching TV with everyone, I preferred to retreat to my room and read or have quiet time. So it's important to look back at your childhood in light of your sensitivity and reframe those experiences and say, yes, I may have been called unsocial, or I may have been called, pick the label that you may have heard: stuck up, unsocial, shy, timid, fearful. I may have been called these things, but now as an adult with some information, I know I was just sensitive. No more than that, I was just sensitive. But this information wasn't out there. The internet wasn't out there when a lot of us were kids. And so people simply didn't know. I do believe that most parents do the best they can. They just didn't know. So, yes, you could have been born a highly sensitive child, and you managed to survive your environment of being the youngest of 10 children. As you got older, and you had more control of your environment, and more control of your life, then it was safe for you to express and to allow more of your sensitivity to be evident. Is that correct?
Yeah.
So, and that's not uncommon. That is not uncommon. And a lot of us, as we age, we kind of move more into ourselves anyway, right? With life experience, with confidence. I think the older we get, the more ourselves we become. And that is particularly true of HSPs. And again, a lot of it has to do with the fact that we have more control of our environment. We have more control of our life, the people who are in it, and how we interact with the world. I hope that answered.
Yeah, because I think of an only child, how they were raised as opposed to how I was raised, and it's such a different world.
It is a different world. I'm an only child. I have two children who are now grown, and it felt like a lot to me. Two kids felt like a lot. Now, my son is at the other end of the spectrum. HSP, it may be inherited, but it wasn't inherited in my children. My son is at the other end, and he felt like three children to me. I love him, he's great. He's a wonderful, he just is designed differently than I am. But I do see the difference that, yes, I was afforded a quieter environment, so probably didn't have to develop the survival techniques that you did in order to stay functional and sane and get through school and young adulthood. I can tell you all are processing. I see you. See some wheels taking all this in. A little bit of smoke coming out. Take care of your sensitive body. HSPs are more likely, if there's a tick on their body, they're gonna feel it before a non-HSP. So this is a gift. A lot of times, if you sense something is wrong with your body, even though it may not be picked up on a clinical test or in a lab report, then do what you need to do to take care of yourself and to follow up as much as you can and deal with your sensitive body. Don't fight your sensitive body. Don't berate your sensitive body. Treat your body as you would a beloved child. If you had a small child who was tired, you would not push them to do more and more and more. You would say, gosh, this child is tired. They've reached their saturation point. They need a break. I'm going to give them a chance to take a break. Do that for yourself. It's very helpful to have morning and evening routines. A morning routine will set the tone for the day, whether it be meditation, prayer, journaling, a nice cup of tea, just you and your tea, a quiet breakfast. And then it's helpful to have an evening routine to help you wind down and prepare for sleep. Absolutely. In fact, that's on the next slide. HSPs do tend to be sensitive to medications. And so we have to look for alternatives. alternative ways to take care of ourselves, and we're going to talk about that. Yeah. Practice creating healthy boundaries. Because we tend to be intuitive and we tend to be empathetic, we can take on things that are not ours and that just are really not our business and not our problem. I see some smiles. I see people, We tend to do that. We have enough. We don't need to take on other people's stuff. So the important word in here is practice. Creating healthy boundaries takes practice. Don't beat yourself up if you don't get it just right. Do your best. Know that you are learning. And the next time, you'll probably do it a little bit better. Creating healthy boundaries is not an easy thing, but you have to take care of yourself before you can take care of anybody else. It's like the airplane announcement. Put your own oxygen mask on first. Take care of yourself. Do not overschedule yourself. If you know you need breaks in your day or breaks in your week in order to function optimally, then give yourself that. I don't work in the afternoons. I'm an energy healer, so I work with folks, and my sessions are usually 60 to 90 minutes long, and I won't see any more than two people back to back, because that's my limit for being able to do a good job and give the folks that I'm working with what they need. Anything beyond two sessions back to back, I would be pulling from a, I would be functioning in a state of depletion, and I wouldn't do myself or the person I'm working with any good. I work in the mornings and I work in the late afternoons. And in the middle of the day, I take a break. Take frequent breaks. If you do have an office job or some kind of work where your schedule is kind of a 9 to 5, then try to get in as many breaks as you can. Water is helpful. Water, just getting water, running your hands under water, putting cold water on your face can be really replenishing and really helpful. Plan in decompression time. If you know you have a busy day at work, you may not want to plan an outing with a friend that evening. So it's about knowing, acknowledging, and honoring your system, and knowing that it's okay if going to work every day is all that you can comfortably do during the week, and you need the evening to chill out. That is perfectly okay. Give yourself permission to do that. Some things you can do on a more practical day-to-day level. Run errands during off hours. You're not going to find me in Walmart on a Saturday afternoon, unless it's an emergency. Have at least one quiet room or space in your home to which you can retreat. It's really helpful if there is a place where your significant other likes to have a TV on a lot, and you have had enough. It's good to have a place where you can retreat and read, look at a magazine, meditate, nap, whatever it is you need to do to get a break from that. Remove yourself from situations that are highly uncomfortable. It's okay for you to leave. If you are at a social gathering or you are voluntarily at some type in a group and you really get uncomfortable, it's okay to leave. explain your trait to others, I would just add the caveat, those that are close to you. You don't need to explain yourself to casual folks, but those that are close to you, those that have a significant role in your life, it's helpful for them to know that you have this trait so they don't take it personally when you disappear for an hour or 2 hours every evening to go recharge. They need to know that truly it's not them, it's you. You just need time to recharge your battery so that you can enjoy your time with them. Seek support. If you're lucky enough to have another HSP in your life, that's great. Then you will probably find a good support system there. And we'll talk more about support in a minute, as far as medical support and other things that you can do to support yourself. And honor your right to be yourself. You were born this way, as Lady Gaga says. You do not have to apologize, and you don't have to feel bad. It is truly, it's a neutral, physiological, neurological trait that manifests itself in these various ways. Here's another quote from the highly sensitive person. Non-HSPs simply do not take in as many of the subtle, disturbing aspects of challenging situations. Your trait in itself is not a fault, but like a finely tuned instrument or machine, or a high-spirited, finely bred animal, you do need special handling. So what does that look like? How do you take care of yourself? You may want to seek out a holistic or alternative medical professional. You might find that they are a little bit more open and accepting of alternative therapies you want to try, whether it be herbal remedies, nutritional remedies, supplements. I work with physicians. I think he's probably a closet energy receiver, but I know that there is a pressure on them to prescribe meds and to fix people quick. So you may want to look for a DO or an alternative healthcare physician. Counseling and talk therapy can be helpful. On Elaine Aaron's website, there's a tab called Therapist, where she provides information on local therapists. The last time I checked, I think there was a counselor in Norfolk who specializes in HSPs and who is an HSP himself. So counseling can be very helpful. Body work. Body work can be very helpful, whether it be massage to help release tension and to literally help open your body so that you don't hold whatever you don't need to hold, including stress, or reflexology. There are many different kinds of body work. Alternative health treatments such as acupuncture, aromatherapy, chiropractic, if these are things that you know your body responds to and you need to feel good and to function, then seek them to the extent that you're able to. And then finally, energy work, which is what I do. Energy work tends to be a good fit for HSPs for a number of reasons. For one thing, energy work is non-invasive. So you don't take off your clothes. You are not being needed I love my massage therapist, but sometimes when she gets into certain places, it can be uncomfortable. So energy work is non-invasive. HSPs tend to be sensitive to medications, just like they're sensitive to caffeine. They can also be sensitive to meds, including over-the-counter meds. HSPs tend to have higher than average sensitivity to pain. So the discomfort of testing or procedures can literally be more painful. Not to mention the environment, the clinical environment can be stressful for HSPs. Most doctors are not HSPs, so they may not quite understand what you experience when you have to undergo certain procedures. HSPs tend to respond well to the gentle, non-invasive nature of energy work. I talked about that. They tend to feel supported in one-to-one interactions. They like to be heard, since they usually will not talk unless they have something that they feel is worth saying. To provide a safe environment where they can talk and express themselves is often very helpful. They are better able to relax and feel nurtured in a calm, peaceful environment. HSPs tend to be very much affected by their environment. They tend not to like clutter or busyness in whatever, whether it's visual busyness or literal physical busyness. They tend to be very attuned and affected by their environment, from everything from temperature, light, really everything in the physical environment. Yes?
Have you done any research with people that have fibromyalgia, and is there a correlation there?
I work with people that have fibromyalgia, and they have been helped by energy work. Because of the non-invasive nature of energy work, and because of energy work, really what we seek to do is get folks in a state of very deep relaxation. And when we're deeply, deeply relaxed, that is when our body is able to tap into its own natural abilities to heal itself. So ideally, our bodies are wise. Our bodies are very wise. And often, given an opportunity, will heal itself. So when we are in a deeply relaxed state, that is when our body is able to turn on those mechanisms that allow for self-healing. And that's one of the goals of energy work, is to help people reach that deeply relaxed state so that their bodies can heal itself. With energy work, the work doesn't stop when the person gets off the table. So a process is started on the table. And ideally, that process continues afterwards, and the healing continues afterwards. And that's it. These are the resources. Again, I highly recommend The Highly Sensitive Person by Elaine Aron. Rosie, is that in the bookstore? Do you know? Okay. The Highly Sensitive Person Survival Guide by Ted Zeff. He is a highly sensitive man, psychologist. So he talks about high sensitivity, but he also has the perspective of being a highly sensitive male. The Highly Sensitive Child, also by Elaine Aron, and then The Strong Sensitive Boy by Ted Zeff, who he says need special attention so that they grow up to be confident and have the esteem that we want our children to have. And this is the website for the two folks. HS Person is where your checklist came from. And there are resources on there. I do not know Elaine Aron. I do not have any financial affiliation with her, so I'm not plugging this for any ulterior motives, other than she is the pioneer. She's highly sensitive herself. And she writes a little bit in the book about her experiences as the youngest of, I think, six children, and how it was not until she reached middle age that she began to understand her trait. And it just so happened that she's a psychologist. So she was able to do the research and had access to the tools and the resources to really define this trait and educate the world and her colleagues, because so many, great. Christy says we do. They're ta-dam, yay. Who even psychologists were not only mislabeling but negatively labeling highly sensitive people. Carl Jung, Abraham Lincoln, there are a lot of highly sensitive, important, famous folks out there. So now, any questions, comments? Yes.